The fire sermon is a very powerful sermon. It seems at that time when the Buddha delivered it, a lot of the yogi or cultivator at that time at the assembly become enlightened. Then it was told in the scripture too, I heard from Reverend Suvano, the heavens, the non-human millions become enlightened. This fire sermon is very powerful. Right? I will go through with you. In the fire sermon, the Buddha taught how one can achieve liberation from suffering through detachment from the five senses and the mind consciousness. In this discourse, the Buddha described the sense basis, the resultant mental consciousness or phenomena as burning. Burning with what? Burning with greed, hatred, and delusion. Because that sutta, they use the word passion. Actually, passion is not the right word. It should be greed. Then aversion is another word for hatred. Then delusion is the same. Burning with greed, hatred, and delusion, and dukkha. Seeing such, a noble disciple become weary or disenchanted with this passion and thus liberated from the sense basis, thereby achieving arahantship. This is described in more detail below. This one, I extracted it from the fire sermon. Yeah. But the English translation of that version is not that accurate. So I have modified some of it. If I'm not wrong, it's from one of the Thai Pali chanting books on the fire sermon. According to the Buddha, he said, thus have I heard on one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Gaya Sisa, accompanied by 1,000 bhikkhu. The Buddha proclaimed, bhikkhu, all things are burning. In Pali, is sabbam. Sabbam is all. Bhikkhave aditan, burning. Aditan is burning. What bhikkhu are these things burning? Then the Buddha said, the eye is burning. Means the eye that is responsible for the seeing consciousness is burning. You have to be mindful of that. Then bhikkhu, the visual form, means color, shape, and form, the sense data are also burning. Visual form, sense data received by the eyes are burning. Then the seeing consciousness is burning. Eye contact is burning. Also, whatsoever feeling felt as pleasant and unpleasant or neutral that arise with eye contact, that too is burning. With what is it burning? Burning with the fire of greed, hatred, and delusion. With the fire of, they use that three words. Greed they put as lust and passion, but I bracket the Pali one, lobha. Then hatred is dosa, and delusion is moha. I say it is burning with birth, old age, sickness, and death. With sorrow, with lamentation, with pain, with grief, with despair. So all this will lead to suffering. Then he go and repeat for all the organ. The ear is burning. Bhikkhu. Sound are burning. Vibration or sense data received by the ear are burning. Hearing consciousness is burning. Ear contact is burning. Whatsoever feeling felt as pleasant, unpleasant, painful, or neither pleasant nor unpleasant that arise with ear contact, that too is burning. With what is it burning again? Burning with the fire of greed, hatred, and delusion. Then repeat. I say it's burning with old age, sickness, and death. Birth, old age, sickness, and death, with sorrow and lamentation, pain, grief and with despair. The Buddha then repeats the same for all the other sense door consciousness as below. The nose, bhikkhu, is burning. So the sense data is order, are burning. Smell and sense data received by the nose are burning. Nose and smell consciousness is burning. Nose contact is burning, etc. Until feeling. The tongue is burning. Tastes are burning. Sense data received by the body, tactile, are burning. So tao or taste consciousness is also burning. Then the contact is also burning. Then feeling that arises also burning. Then the body, bhikkhu, is burning. Tactile sensations are burning. Tactile feeling or sense data received by the body are burning. Bodily tactile consciousness is burning. Tongue contact is burning. Then feeling that arises burning. Then similarly, the mind is burning. Thoughts are burning. Mental objects received by the mind are burning. Then mental consciousness is burning. Mind contact is burning. And whatever feeling that arises is also burning. With what is it burning? Burning with the three evil roots of greed, hatred, and delusion. I say it is burning with birth, old age, sickness, and death, with sorrow, with lamentation, with pain, with grief, and with despair. Bhikkhu, this part you must listen. When a noble disciple who has heard this truth and clearly see them thus in their meditation with mindfulness, he becomes wary of the eye, wary of visual form, wary of eye or seeing consciousness, wary of eye contact, wary of whatsoever feeling that arises at contact. Then he becomes wary of all the feeling that arises too. Then he becomes wary of all the similarly for all the organs, the ear, the nose, the tongue, all repeated, and bodily tactile, and finally thought consciousness. So I will read the thought consciousness. He becomes wary of his mind, the mundane mind, wary of the thought, the mental form, wary of mind and thought consciousness, wary of mind contact, and wary of whatsoever that is felt as feeling with mind contact. So all this, when you are mindful, you can observe them, experience them. Then when you know how they lead to suffering, misery, that's why it's like burning, burning. So the enlightened being, the Arya, they will not hold, they will not grasp, they will not cling, because they can't. That's why every moment of seeing, hearing, smell, taste, tactile, or thought consciousness, they are very different. They cannot be deceived. The phenomenal world of consciousness and form cannot delude them anymore, because they realize all these are the source of suffering, the cause of suffering. When you attach, grab, and cling, you become afflicted. You get yourself entangled. So this fire servant is very good. It triggers off the understanding of the urgency of cultivation. When you cultivate and develop the sensitivity and understand, it's really like see it burning. So our example that I used to give you is like your problem in life. Because you suffer mentally, you don't perceive it so clearly. You don't understand that you are suffering because you still have wrong view, wrong thought, and you blame people for what happened. But if, let's say, that problem that you have is like a burning charcoal or a molten burning thing, when you hold on to it, what happened? You can feel that it is burning you, tormenting you, making you miserable. So the fire sermon is the same. Everything that you are mindful of is burning because you can see it leading to suffering. And in that case, it's mental suffering. But because mental suffering, they don't burn you and torment you. You cannot see it. But you suffer, you become miserable. So the analogy of holding on to something that burn you and torment you is very, very beautiful and can awaken you. So if it's burning you and tormenting you, what is the right thing for you to do? Don't hold on to that thing anymore, understand or not? Because it's burning you and tormenting you. So put it down. Put it down means what? I don't call it let go, understand or not? Because who let go? Only a person who is deluded will attach and cling and hold. And how can he let go when he has that delusion? So when you understand, you will not hold. That's why you put it down. When you put it down, you feel what? Relief, isn't it? It's no more burning you and tormenting you. But the question is, that thing that is burning you and tormenting you is your problem. So you will always have that thought telling you, my problem is that one. I haven't resolved it. So what must you do? Yes, you must resolve it, but not by holding on to it, understand? When you hold on to it, you suffer, you become miserable. In that mind state, you don't have clarity of mind. How can you understand what is going on? Then how can you resolve it? So the right thing is not to hold. Not to hold means accept the reality of the moment, then don't react to it, don't stir, don't do anything. Be at peace. Then with that clarity of mind, when you are not suffering, when you don't have fear, worry, anxiety, sorrow and lamentation, unhappiness, misery, then you have clarity of mind. You can act. Then you ask yourself, you inquire, what actually happened? Then you ask yourself, how can I act with wisdom to resolve it amicably so that there is no coming implication? That's how you act. Act with wisdom, following Noble Eightfold Path, which is the meditation as taught by the Buddha. And Noble Eightfold Path is without evil. That's why there is right action. There is the right way to act. So acting according to memory is not acting at all. Acting with wisdom is the right way to act. Right view, following Noble Eightfold Path. And then you don't have to hold on to that thing and become miserable. You inquire, what happened? You call it a problem because you perceive it with negativity. You go and worry about it. You go and project your thought. You stir your mind. You react to what happened. But according to the Buddha, what happened is the reality. That is what is, according to Jaya Krishnamurti. The reality of the moment. Where the Buddha said, whatever that arises, there are causes and conditions behind. So what are the causes and conditions? Under the five daily contemplation, the last one, he already said, we are all born of our karma, heir to our karma, conditioned and supported by our karma. We are what we are because of karma. So very likely it's connected to karma. That's why you have to take care of karma, otherwise you suffer, you become miserable. So if the causes and conditions already set, means things is just the way it is. It cannot be otherwise. Like the Buddha said, when condition is like that, things will be like that. It cannot be other way. If you want things your way, you suffer, you become miserable. It means you lack wisdom. You attach, you cling, you grasp. Nature's law that governs life and existence is very fair. Whatever that arises, there are causes and it means in the past you had done all this nonsense to people, now you become the victim. That's why you are hit. Then you perceive in negativity, get angry, stir your mind and become miserable. There is suffering. There is your payback time, karmic friction. So when you understand all this, then you tell yourself, if this is karma, then I accept. Then I am at peace. Then I do what I have to do to move on. What must I do? If I need to ask for forgiveness, repent, I do. Then I vow not to repeat all this by following the advice of the Buddha to cultivate. the advice of the Buddha, to avoid all evil, I keep the precept. Then to cultivate wholesomeness, I cultivate Noble Eightfold Path, the first six path factors. Then I meditate to purify my mind, to develop the wisdom. Then I change my life. I transform. My life become beautiful. Then when I take care of my precept, I will protect myself and protect others. I don't harm others. I don't create karmic negativity. So I don't have to pay back. There is no karmic negativity. That's why I don't have to suffer anymore from that moment onward, except the past coming that I haven't resolved. From now onward, your life will transform, become beautiful. That's how you become a true cultivator, a Dharma practitioner, a Buddhist, worthy of the Buddhist, the Buddha as your teacher, means a devotee, a Buddhist devotee. To be worthy of the Buddha, you must at least follow his advice to avoid all evil, cultivate wholesomeness, and purify your mind. So this teaching is very beautiful. So when you understand all this, then you know this is the way forward. This is the way to change your life, to transform your life, to improve your life. And these are no need money. Don't go and waste money on feng shui, on all the fortune telling and all those things. Forget about it, because like the Buddha say, your life is entirely depend on karma. You don't take care of karma, whatever you do will not benefit you, will not help you, will not change your life. Things that will change your life is only your karma. You need wisdom to take care of karma. You need to cultivate appropriately, accordingly, following the advice of the Buddha. Live life the Dhamma way. So this is most beautiful. So you can solve your problem already. You no need to cling on to your problem, hold on to your problem, and suffer and become miserable. And yet you don't know you are suffering. But if you reflect on this fire sermon, everything is burning. Means whatever you perceive as problem is burning. But when you perceive it with negativity, it becomes a problem. But if I don't perceive it with negativity, I accept the reality of the moment with wisdom based on what the Buddha has taught me and based on my mindfulness training that I have observed and seen, that everything is dependent, originating, condition, arising, causal phenomena. He know you, he know me. There is no reality. Only mighty nature rolling by. Then why do we cling? Why do we grasp? When we come with nothing. When we leave this world, we leave with nothing. That's why the famous Mandarin saying, Lai ye kong, qi ye kong. Na mo si zu, her bi ku ku, in between, wei kong liu le. So if your coming is empty, your going is empty, then why do you grieve in between over emptiness? You come with nothing, means empty. You go also cannot take along anything, also empty. Then why do you suffer and become tormented and grieve in between? For nothing, over what? Emptiness. That's why you cannot see sunyata, emptiness, you cannot awaken. You cannot realize the three universal characteristics of impermanent, suffering state, non-self or empty nature. You cannot awaken. You will not have this wisdom. Then you cannot understand life. You cannot understand the reality within life. The present moment reality, the highest in life. And that is the highest, no? The present moment. And the only reality in life. But how stable is the present moment? Split second is day and gone. Split second is day. So what is life? How real can life be? It is so transient. If it exhibit this characteristic of impermanence so clearly in front of you. That's why without mindfulness, you cannot see. You don't have the sensitivity. You don't have the understanding. You are like blind, heedless. That's how living beings suffer, become afflicted. So all these teachings are very beautiful. So we go back to the notes. Today's recording is very good. You should go through it. So this fire sermon, now we come to the final summary. In this way, the Buddha said, the bhikkhu or the enlightened disciple, he becomes free of passion, free of greed, hatred, and delusion, and he becomes aware of feeling with insight knowledge and wisdom, means with the right view after he has straightened his view. He knows there is no more rebirth. The holy life is his, that he has done all that should be done, means beyond training. Yeah. These were the blessed one's words when he spoke to the bhikkhu thus. The whole congregation of over 1,000 bhikkhu rejoiced and approved of his words and attained liberation from the asavak. Asavak are the latent tendency, yeah? The very strong defilement through clinging no more, and their hearts were completely free, and they all become arahant. Bhikkhu. So under notes, I will read through from another commentary, which is also quite good. Bhikkhu is a form is burning, feeling is burning, perception is burning. This one easier to relate to based on our familiar terms. Volitional formation are burning, and consciousness is burning. Seeing thus, the instructed noble disciple experience vary towards form. You can replace the word vary with this enchantment. Feeling, perception, volitional formation, and consciousness. Through dispassion, see the word dispassion, disenchantment. And this mind is liberated, so it's the same as above, from the asava, through clinging no more, and the hearts were completely free. The ensuring text reveal that all sabbe refer to the six internal sense bases, alayatana. They are your eye, your ear, your nose, your tongue, your body, and mind. Somebody didn't mute. The speaker was on. We will mute for you, don't worry. Okay. I read again. The six internal sense bases, they are your five physical senses and your mind. Eye, ear, nose, tongue, bodily tactile, and mind. Then the six external sense bases, they are visual form, sound or vibration, then smell, taste, touches, and mental object. Consciousness, vijnana, contingent on these sense bases, their respective what they call consciousness will arise. So like the eye give rise to seeing consciousness, the eye give rise to hearing consciousness, the tongue taste consciousness, the body tactile consciousness, and the mind thought consciousness. Then by burning, the Pali word is aditan, is meant with the fire of, he used the word passion, actually is greed, greed, the root of greed. But the Pali word is ragagina, ragagina. That's why they use the word passion. Raga is a type of negative passion. It's like lust, like that, raga. Then the fire of aversion means dosar, jina. Then the fire of delusion, moha, jina. Only the first word, they don't use loba. They use raga. I think raga is a stronger word. It's a very like lustful. Like that. The manifestation of suffering refers to the first noble truth reality, birth, old age, sickness, and death, leading to sorrow, lamentation, pain, distress, and despair. Because this arises the whole mess of suffering. With birth comes existence. Existence brings about suffering, when you don't have wisdom. Yeah. So initially, before you become enlightened, you will suffer. Then there is a very good saying, I think. Disenchanted, he becomes dispassionate. Through dispassion, he is fully released. With full release, there is understanding. Fully released, he discerns that birth is ended, the holy life fulfilled, the task done. There is nothing further for this world. Means you become Aseka, beyond training. No need to train really. So this poem is very good, in fact. So through wisdom, you start to understand that everything is burning. Then you will not touch it, understand? You will not cling onto it. You will not grasp onto it. So all these senses, they are like a physical tool for you to use. So use it. Don't be attached to it. Don't cling onto it. Don't grasp onto it. Don't believe that this is you. This is real. You want to own it. You want to possess it. All these are delusion. So understand, the form and mind is karmically conditioned from our karmic nature out for us to come to this existential world, to live life, to experience life, to go through life, to do whatever that we need to do with our life. So make use of it like a tool. Use it. Do not cling. Do not be deluded by it. Even your mind is the same, like a tool. Use it with wisdom appropriately. So like a tool, use it to help you, to benefit you and others, to be a blessing to all. So take for example, you have a knife, which is also a tool. If we use it appropriately, correctly, means what? We use it to cut fruits, cut vegetables, shape things, carve things, and do whatever that we want to do with it. But if instead, we use it to cut ourselves, harm ourselves, hurt ourselves, and hit our at others, or kill and harm others, that is the wrong way of using that tool, isn't it? But precisely, deluded living beings, the heedless, they are using their thought wrongly to arise the wrong thought, to harm themselves, to hurt themselves, to make themselves miserable, until they have so much sorrow, lamentation, and misery, until they enter depression. That's why they create this cocoon of wrong thought that condition their fear, their worry, their anxiety, their sorrow, their lamentation, their deep resentment, their hatred, their unhappiness, leading to all the various misery, sorrow and lamentation, grief. So all these are mental states that denotes misery, suffering, affliction. So if you don't want to suffer, you better wake up. You better reverse all this to an understanding. Better cultivate Noble Eightfold Path to root out all the wrong thought, wrong speech, and wrong action. So this is the way forward. There is no other teaching more beautiful than the Buddha's teaching, especially Noble Eightfold Path, that leads to the end of all suffering.